Hey everybody, this is Love and Relo, the voice of the relocation industry. I am your host, Ben Cross. Today we have a wonderful show for you. We have James Reid, employment law expert, on the program today to talk all about the CARES Act and COVID-19 and some of the resources that are out there for employers and employees. So I'm really excited to bring him on. Before we get started, want to go ahead and give a shout out to our sponsor, Pivot App. Today's episode of Love and Relo is sponsored by Pivot. Did you know that up to one third of assignees leave their post early? At Pivot, we want to change that. Pivot is the social mobility app designed to make a new city feel like home. How do we do that? We provide crowdsourced data from friends, coworkers, and other expats to give the best possible advice for assignees abroad. We can improve assignment success rates and help employees thrive, all for only $6. Contact Lynn Greenberg, founder of Pivot, at lynn@pivotapp.com. That's lynn@pivotapp.com. And I think they're actually running a special. So if you want to let them know that you saw it on Love and Relo, you can actually get your first month's subscriptions free. So that's really cool. I'm going to bring our guest on the line right now. James Reid.
Hey, happy to be here.
Hey, it's good to have you on. For the people out there who are watching that may not be familiar with you, can you tell us a little bit about your firm first, Dinsmore and Shohl?
Yeah, so I am at a national law firm with about 28 offices coast to coast, and we have 60 different practice areas, and I'm located in Michigan. In the Ann Arbor and Troy offices. And my specialty is business and employment law. So this is the extra busy time with lots of phone calls given this unfortunate pandemic.
I imagine you're getting a ton of calls right now from companies wondering how to handle this type of a situation, especially since it's unprecedented. What are some of the things you're hearing most right now?
Yeah, so unfortunately, even though it's April Fool's Day, this is no joke. There are no regulations that clearly articulate all the loopholes in the 110-page bill. And so particularly with the FFCRA, Families First Coronavirus Response Act, people don't know if they should be on unemployment right now, if they should furlough employees, if they should be laid off, terminated. What's the difference between all of those things? Could someone be partially unemployed and work a little bit and get some unemployment? Or there's even talks of a work share program. So there are so many options. Nobody even knows how to even, you know, evaluate the pros and cons of those options.
So you bring up like a ton of really great things. Let's back up and let's kind of set the table here real quick. And I see a whole bunch of people coming in on LinkedIn. Everybody that's watching real quick, throw your name, company name, location in there. Love to give you some shout outs as well. We're also going to be taking questions from James Reid right now. So, hey, free legal advice. I don't know if I can say that or not, but I mean, that's pretty priceless. So, so go ahead and leave your questions in there and then we'll get to those as well. And also if you're watching, go ahead and hit like, hit the celebration button. Let everybody know you're checking it out. So, James, let's go back here and just tell people about the pieces of legislation that have come out in the last week or two designed to help people and companies in these times.
Yeah. So first there was the Families First Coronavirus Response Act. That was a week ago. Then last Friday, there was the CARES Act. And that adds that additional stimulus money to give loans to many businesses and also increases unemployment. God. So the CARES Act is adding an additional $600 benefit to unemployment per week from now through July 31st for those that are eligible.
So let's use the state of Michigan, right, as an example, because that's where I'm sitting right now, right? Yeah. So if I were to go on unemployment right now, what would that look like to me and my family for like a weekly basis?
So given the CARES Act, the concept was to make it an extra $600. They didn't want to get into the details and formula of calculating what would be the right unemployment rate. So you could get a windfall. You could get the maximum unemployment rate of 362 per week. And then on top of that, get an additional $600 per week. So 962 a week, you know, you're making close to 50 grand a year at that rate. And yes, the average worker doesn't make $50,000. So pretty much any employee that has been earning around $30,000 a year is most likely eligible for the full 962 a week.
So for employees that are earning kind of on the low end there, that 30 grand or 32 or, you know, under 50,
yeah,
they'd actually be getting a raise going on unemployment right now?
Yes.
That seems like it, well, I guess it seems like it would pose kind of a conundrum for employers who are trying to keep their workforce, you know, engaged, right? And at the helm, it's like, if I can go, you know, maybe I'm making 32 grand a year, right? I could go make more money sitting at home on unemployment. Do you see with your clients that poses any kind of, you know, walkouts or anything?
It's a major issue, but there are ways to minimize that incentive. So for example, if your employee is actually able to be open, let's say you're an essential business, you're a nurse, doctor, and you need to be open to help the public, maybe even a grocery store.
A moving company, we're deemed essential in the state of Michigan.
Exactly. So if you were to refuse work that's available to you, that could be a disqualification event from unemployment, and then you don't get anything on either side. So that's one way to incentivize.
So it can't be voluntary. Like, I can't say, you know what, gosh, you know, I'd rather just stay home, collect unemployment. It has to be a decision made for me by my employer through a layoff or a furlough. Are those my options as employer?
Typically, you'd be correct. Governor Whitmer actually made an order saying there are additional ways to get unemployment. So if you have a child at home that needs you to be their caregiver because their school is closed, that could be another way where you could be getting unemployment right now, because the whole concept is we don't want to incentivize people that may be sick to try to get some additional income. So we want to make them more than whole by hopefully staying at home and being with their family.
Now, if I'm you know what, actually, I'm gonna open this. I'm gonna open my window here. I'm gonna take a little window break here. But if I'm an employer right now, and yeah, I want to make sure that I'm abiding by the law. I want to make sure that, you know, I'm not running afoul of any of the changing requirements right now. Can you let us know, what are some of the requirements now? I mean, do we have to communicate anything with our employees? Do we have to let them know certain things? Help us understand that.
So there is the Governor Whitmer stay-at-home order throughout Michigan. Mm-hmm. And then there is that essential business carve-out. But if an essential business is in, for example, Oakland County, Wayne County, or Washtenaw County, they actually have additional requirements to follow. So you're either required to take an employee's temperature or a customer coming in the building to make sure they don't have a fever. I think it's over 101. And you need to make sure, or to the extent you can't get the thermometers, they're on back order, you have to ask a list of survey questions to see if anybody has any symptoms of COVID-19 to make sure you're minimizing potential exposure. And following the 6-foot rule, where you don't let people interact within 6 feet of one another. You have a poster on the outside of your building and on the inside explaining, you know, wash your hands and follow various sanitary conditions.
So you have to have a poster about the sanitary conditions, and you're also required to screen all employees when they come in, and they have to have a fever. So they can't have a fever over 101, but if they have a fever of like a 99 or 100, like, that seems kind of bad too.
So you're not required to reject them, but I am seeing a lot of companies erring on the side of caution. So if that person, you know, feels like they have a fever that's higher than their normal temperature, send them home, let them quarantine. I'm seeing a lot of having somebody quarantine for 14 days. If they've been exposed to someone that has coronavirus. So if even if they don't have it, but were exposed, like for example, a company has someone that attended work that ends up having it, we usually quarantine everyone that was around that person for 14 days.
Wow. Interesting. So there's a lot of requirements for from an employer standpoint as well. I want to give some shout outs real quick to some folks that are tuning in here. Jamie Massler. Hey, Ben and James, cheers from sunny Mississippi. All right. All right, Jamie. Anthony Walmsley. Wow, he looks rich. I'm assuming that's for you right there.
I don't know about that. I'm just in a little office right now.
Yeah. I guess you got it. Yeah, that's funny.
You in the parking lot in the background.
These are the guys from the UK. They're probably been drinking already. So just, you know, you got to take it with a grain of salt. Simon Johns. Hi, Ben and James from the UK. Another guy from the UK. Awesome. Love to see also folks from the UK. Love to just hear kind of what you're seeing out there, because I know that they've been doing some interesting things as well from a stimulus and employee support standpoint over there. Maureen Longoria. Hi, Ben. Enjoying your shows this past week. Thanks. Appreciate that, Maureen. Jonathan Farmer. Hey, Ben. Checking from Dallas. Thanks for covering this topic. You're welcome, Jonathan. Drew Phillips. Hey, guys. Drew here from sunny California. Loving my Love and Relo. Appreciate you, Drew. Thanks for participating. Molly Feldman, Molly from Jacksonville is here. Great, Molly. Brian Rivers. Hello again, Brian from Sacramento. Hey, Brian, becoming a regular. I appreciate that. Anthony Walmsley. Hi, Ben. We are currently working on the emergency hospital ward moves. This is in the UK. We are seeing it all. We are the only company in the Northwest doing this. We are essential. Appreciate you doing that, Anthony. I know it's difficult. Hi, Ben from Powell Relocation Group, Dallas, Texas. Hey, Kathleen. Brian from First Tech Federal Credit Union. Katie Linehan from Middletown, Connecticut. Hey, I'd love to see you, if you're watching right now, I'd love to hear your questions. If you're an employer who manages people, if you are a business owner, if you are an employee who's concerned, frankly, about furloughs, about being laid off. I know I'm hearing a lot of stories this week from friends of mine in the industry who are seeing layoffs happen at their company, who maybe have been victims of layoffs and furloughs. We're gonna pause the comments right now. I'm gonna let you kind of ask some questions in there, because I want you to be able to ask James Reid and kind of pick his brain, because he's kind of a genius with these things. But I'm gonna have, I have a question. This came up yesterday. What's the difference between a furlough and a layoff?
So every company is kind of treating it a little bit differently, but essentially with a furlough, you want to keep your employees on your health insurance to the extent you're offering it. And it's typically a planned temporary leave. So the goal is to bring you back in 2 weeks, and we'll reevaluate if we're able to bring you back every 2 weeks and check in and keep you updated. Where a layoff more likely is, I'm going to give you a COBRA notice and may or may not ever bring you back again.
And is there a burden of proof or anything where a company has to say, you know, there's been a work slowdown or there's an elimination of this position, or is there anything like that that's a difference between the two?
Yeah. So if you were going to do a layoff that was going to last more than 6 months, and you're at a company that is over 100 employees, you would have WARN Act obligations. So that's
what is that?
That's the Worker Adjustment Retraining Notification Act. So if you were going to lay off, you know, a third of your department or 50% of your employees or various numbers of employees, you have to give them 60 days advance notice before you lay them off. So if you were to lay people off and not be aware of all the other laws that apply, you could be having a WARN Act violation, and then you'd have to do back pay for 60 days for all of those workers. Plus, it was like a $500 a day fine for each day you're not in compliance.
So let me get this straight here. I want to make sure I heard you correctly. You're saying if I were to do a, say I'm an employer, if I were to do a layoff, I need to give people 60 days notice before they're laid off?
If you are over 100 employees.
Over 100 employees. Okay.
And there is some defenses. So typically your defense right now would be, I couldn't foresee this happening. There's a pandemic. So there is some arguments that given a pandemic, some of the laws are not as strictly enforced. So to give you an example, I had mentioned earlier about we're able to take the temperature of our employees and ask certain questions about, you know, their symptoms. Usually that would be an Equal Employment Opportunity Commission issue when you're inquiring into someone's disabilities or their how they're doing, you know, privately, their private health information and other mm-hmm. things. During a pandemic, you can ask about someone's temperature and symptoms. So the EEOC issued guidance, I think 2 weeks ago, saying it's okay now to take an employee's temperature, where otherwise, outside of a pandemic, you can't.
Wow. Okay, that's interesting, because I did have a question about that, because I mean, you're dealing with medical information, which is typically protected, I think. So, but you're saying some of that is suspended now. So let's say an employee goes home sick or with symptoms, right? Complaining right. about symptoms, goes home. I think it's, you know, if they're gone for 2 or 3 days, they have to have a doctor's note to return to work. In this situation, this pandemic, have those rules changed at all? Or how do you handle employees that go home out of a abundance of caution or with mild symptoms? Is it handled any differently?
So I actually attended our healthcare attorney lunch meeting earlier today. And we're seeing the normal company is saying, once you've been exposed to anyone with coronavirus or have any symptoms of coronavirus, we're doing a full out 14-day quarantine.
So any symptoms, and that could mean dry cough, or do you have to have all four?
So, you know, as lawyers, we don't give doctor advice or, but our understanding is most doctors are instructing a 14-day quarantine with any of those symptoms, unless they're able to do a diagnosis of something else. So I have seen someone where they know for sure it's bronchitis. So then maybe they'll authorize you to come back sooner, but still you may be uncomfortable coughing and hacking up a lung when people think maybe it's contagious coronavirus. So you may, if you're able to work remotely, that is best practices, but not every position allows for that. And as far as doctor notes, it's really hard. Everyone I know that is feeling symptoms can't even see a doctor. Instead, they just have a quick phone call, talk about some of their symptoms. And the recommendation I hear typically is just self-quarantine for 14 days. So,
yeah, right. Which now if I'm an employee who is told to self-quarantine for 14 days, and we're going to get to the questions here, because I have some comments and questions coming in. But if I'm an employee that says that, you know, hey, I got to self-quarantine now for 14 days, and I'm unable to earn money because I can't go to work, am I filing unemployment, or what is the, what do I
Great.
Do?
So that is what is addressed in the FFCRA, Families First Coronavirus Response Act, and with unemployment. So with the Families First Coronavirus Response Act, if someone, let's say you, Ben, today have a cough and a fever, you could, and you're trying to actively seek a medical diagnosis, that would trigger, assuming you're at a company that's under 500 employees, that would trigger the paid sick leave portion of that law. And you're allowed to get up to $511 per day for up to 10 days. So 80 hours.
Oh, wow. Well, that's a lot better than the unemployment rate as well.
It is. So although it's not an automatic up to 511, it's matching your full income that can't exceed 511 per day. And let's say, you know, I see you out and about, you're a busy guy. If you're averaging 60 hours a week, you could collect 60 hours of your sick leave in week one, then collect 20 hours of it in week two. And then you would, if you need to also be at home after that to care for a sick child, a portion of the leave is emergency family medical leave to care for like a closed school or a child. And that's where you can get up to $200 a day after the 2 week waiting period for 10 weeks.
What's the best resource for people to go online and figure out all these programs? Where should they look?
So I'm very lucky that Dinsmore does a hub. So we have a coronavirus hub. If you go to dinsmore.com, you'll be able to click on the main homepage. You'll see the first thing that pops up is a hub that identifies all of the common questions and answers that people have and all the links to various resources to get a lot of your questions, you know, asked and answered.
Okay, and I'll put that right there. Make sure that's right, dinsmore.com. Yep. And then that's where you find that Q&A.
And awesome. If you wanted to get an email sent to you whenever we have a new update, I'm happy to add you to our email blast list as well.
Okay, wonderful. Let's go. Let's check out a couple of these comments here from folks here on, looks like Facebook's got a couple. Janet Turner checking in from Florida. Appreciate you, Janet. Jason Rollins with Express Corporate Housing checking in from Foxborough. TB12. Tom Brady have a coronavirus regimen. Houston Horn from Mobile, Alabama. You know, so Houston actually asks a question here. Business owner. So they're Houston's a business owner. Concerned about it all. My crew is beginning to become shaky about going out on jobs despite being deemed essential business. What recourse or action can Houston take there and help us
explain? So yeah, this? I appreciate your question, Houston. That is a common issue a lot of my clients are seeing as well. What I would do is almost treat it as if an employee was requesting an accommodation. So what makes you uncomfortable? Are you listening to false news? Is there something we can do to make sure we're keeping you, 6 feet away from people on most jobs? And, frankly, unless you're aware of some tier one hazardous work condition where people have coronavirus and we're making people sick, it's not appropriate to reject work that isn't going to likely cause serious bodily harm. So if those employees can't prove that the working conditions are imminent death or serious bodily harm, they still should be accepting that work when they couldn't otherwise work remotely.
So Houston is, I'm guessing Houston is with a moving company, and the nature of being with a moving company, right, is you're in people's homes. You can remain distant from people, but you're going to be exposed to surfaces, and you're just it is what it is, right?
Right.
So I guess, how much can you push back on employees, and how much do you have to kind of respect their prerogative and their decision? And,
it's a great question. I would look at, if you have a handbook policy, what does your policy say? Does it allow people to take their personal time or use PTO without any questions asked? Maybe, if they have that perk, let them take it. And if you wanted to challenge their unemployment benefits claim, you may be able to, but if you essentially wanted to lay them off because you didn't have enough work for everybody and you're, picking people that you think would have the best attitude on the job, then maybe they could be on unemployment benefits or be on a furlough temporarily until things get better.
Mm-hmm. And if somebody wanted help with drafting a policy or putting some things like that on paper and enacting those things, I'm sure they could reach out to you.
Yeah, we are preparing those furlough letters, the layoff letters, termination letters, and we're also helping with all the notices of what information you need, because if it is approved leave that's under the Family First Coronavirus Response Act, you're going to want to have that documented. So you can get all that money, the employer can get all that money reimbursed. So the best part about FFCRA is that 511 and the FMLA can get fully reimbursed through payroll taxes and other tax deductions so that the company is not at a loss for any of that advancement.
Awesome. Makes sense. Let's see here. We had another question as well here from Janet. Love these questions on Facebook too. I can put them right here on the screen. Janet asks, what if you have a client who was diagnosed and wants to reschedule for 2 weeks? There are others living in the home. Can we request proof of negative test results and or scan for temperatures?
So great question. Yes, it appears clear to me that you can scan for temperatures. Typically, I would want to get a doctor's note to see how long someone may be contagious. I have heard that you're contagious for, 72 hours after your symptoms stop. So I would probably, maybe you want to make sure that typically 14 days from whenever any of those other family members may have been exposed to that person while they were contagious. So that could extend the 14-day deadline. And yes, I would probably want to take their temperature or ask them certain questions, but I have not seen someone go as far as to require the actual negative test results before providing service.
Yeah, I mean, because they could then infect other people in the home who might be in an incubation period of some sort, and now the clock starts over again, So yep. I could see that being a concern, I've had reports where we've gone into homes and someone's sick in the home, and you don't know if it's a cold, it's a flu, it's coronavirus, it's bronchitis, it's whatever, and it's like, but of course they got to move, so they're not trying to move their date because can you refuse the business? I mean, I guess this is my question, right? If I'm in the home, my crew calls me up and they say, this guy's got a cough right now and we don't feel safe, whatever. Can we refuse the business? I mean, is there any?
Sure. So, I'm seeing each state to be some differences. I would start first with your local state order. And if it has, for example, don't get within 6 feet of someone else, I would require that those homeowners not be present when you're moving their stuff and try to work out some other accommodations to see a way to protect the workers and protect other people from exposure.
Yeah, it makes sense. And can I give people your email address if they want to, if they want to engage with you?
So it's my first name, James, last name, Reid, @dinsmore.com. And happy to be a resource.
Awesome. We've got a couple more comments coming in here. Steve Christie, South Carolina, Move Management, Huntington Beach. SC Move Management, Huntington Beach, California. Yeah, we've got people all over the country here. I'm assuming you do practice law.
We have two offices in California, San Diego and LA.
Fantastic. Wes Strubing from Customized Logistics Group checking in. Sandra Clary, watching from Alexandria, Virginia. And she is unfortunately or was a COVID-19 termination. Is there a distinction in qualifying? Her question is there a distinction in qualifying for the CARE Act plus $600 a week and whether the employer called it a termination versus a layoff? My company called it a termination and letting us all go. Thank you.
So I think the company most likely meant layoff. You weren't terminated for misconduct. So as long as the company doesn't claim that you were terminated for misconduct, such as stealing from the company or committing some grossly intentional evil act, you should get your full unemployment benefits. Each state could have their own nuances, but in Michigan, just because they have the word terminated, you would still get most likely the 962 unless the employer adds additional verbiage that you were fired for misconduct.
Right. And I don't think that was the case in Sandra's instance. So she would then qualify most likely for the CARE Act, which is the $600 a week in addition to her state unemployment.
Yeah, the way the CARE Act $600 works is if you're eligible for unemployment under your state agency, you should get that extra $600 on top.
Is it a separate application process?
Nope.
No. Okay. Awesome. Because that's the other thing. I'm like looking at all these, great things that have been brought out. I mean, they are wonderful. And I applaud the government for doing these things. But I do get worried. I'm like, oh, it seems kind of, I'm sure there's some bureaucracy. It sounds like there's probably gonna be a lot of forms to fill out. Are these hard to apply for? Are they super easy?
So the challenge with unemployment right now is that if you're calling, I'm hearing waiting times of 4 to 7 hours, at least in Michigan.
Oh my gosh.
So there's an online way to file, but the good news is in Michigan, you can have retroactive application. They're not going to give you like, hey, you couldn't get through for a few days. We're not going to count your benefits until after another 1 week waiting period. They're waiving the waiting period, allowing you to have some retroactive pay. So it should be relatively easy and seamless. And then with respect to the CARES Act stimulus, any, you know, person that filed their 2018 or 19 tax return should be getting a $1,200 check without filing anything, as long as they were making, it starts phasing out at $75,000 of income for a single tax filer, $150,000 for a joint filer, and then you get an extra $500 per kid. So that should
now happen. If my kid doesn't make 75 grand, can I get the 500 if I make my, because
so there's a formula that's also on our Dinsmore link that shows the formula to phase it out. But if you're making over 75 grand, you could still qualify between you and your wife. You're not making over 150.
Okay. So it doesn't matter what my kid's earning, because he's not pulling in. These are the employment law jokes. Stephen Meyer, he is a owner operator driver and he is in Alexandria, Virginia. Stephen, thank you for tuning in. I'm going to ask a question for Stephen, because this has been something I've been hearing a lot of owner operator drivers asking. They say all this to help employees is great, right? All this stuff to help employees that are out of work, displaced, whatever. I'm an owner operator. I'm an independent contractor. I'm a 1099. What do I get?
So in Michigan, the unemployment was expanded to allow independent contractors and self-employed individuals to also get on unemployment during this time. So check with your state. It may be the same for you in your state as well.
And are they using the same, looking at your tax returns from the year prior to determine where you are in that? So if I'm self-employed, but my business grows $0 last year, I'm probably not eligible for unemployment, or would I still be?
Unemployment is based on you not earning any income in a particular work week. So as long as in Michigan, as long as you earned over like $6,000 or $5,500 in the last year, you're eligible for unemployment. Okay. There's a complicated formula to see how much you're eligible for. But if you earned more than $30,000 in the past year, typically you'd be eligible for the full 362 plus the 600. So it sounds like you'd be eligible for something. I don't know how the formula is going to apply to a independent contractor, but you should get a $600 on top of that is how I'm reading the law.
Okay. You know, if you're Stephen, if you're out there or any other owner operators, I know that you've had a lot of questions about this stuff. So love it if you folks would ask some questions. Also, if you're an employee and you're facing a furlough, or if you're an employer and you're thinking about the best way to navigate these times right now and how to handle employees as you have a work slowdown, please ask a question. I'd really love to ask James while we have him here. Some really good stuff here. Let's see here. We've got a few more comments here. Joshua Rose says, hey guys, dialing in for Virginia. Lucky I dialed in for the Saul Goodman episode. Oh, this is like a Better Call Saul.
Better Call Saul.
Nice. That's funny. Jamie Massler, wife has been furloughed. Good luck getting through to the unemployment office. She's been trying for about 5 days.
So I am seeing, if you go on the state website, depending on your last name, where it falls in the alphabet, they're trying to have certain days for certain letters and trying to make the bandwidth be more available. But it is a challenge. I heard on a radio show today that even the IRS is furloughing some people and you aren't able to get through to them. It's just as challenging to get through to the IRS.
Wow. Let's really quick. We got some more questions and comments coming in. I want to answer all your questions real quick. I'm going to check in with our advertiser real quick again. Today's episode of Love and Relo is sponsored by Pivot. Did you know that up to one third of assignees leave their post early? At Pivot, we want to change that. Pivot is the social mobility app designed to make a new city feel like home. How do we do that? We provide crowdsourced data from friends, coworkers, and other expats to give the best possible advice for assignees abroad. We can improve assignment success. All right, James, there you are.
I'm here.
Yeah, my Wi-Fi is shaky here. My kids might be on the Fire Stick right now. I don't know what's going on.
They're probably streaming something fun.
They probably are. Let's see. I guarantee you they're not watching this. Let's see. Sandra Clary. People are sympathizing with Sandra there. Simon Johns. Simon Johns, again from the UK, would like to make a comment. When speaking to banks and credit card providers, would you have to provide proof of being on furloughed leave?
So that's another article that is common in the world, and it's the force majeure concept. So there's a clause in many contracts that says in the event of a force majeure event, you may be able to not fully follow your contracts and your obligations. So I know a lot of credit card companies are deferring interest. There's even deferrals of student loan interest and additional ways for companies to give non-taxable help towards student aid and other perks. So I'm not aware of a credit card company asking for evidence if you've been furloughed or laid off. I think they understand the pandemic and they're willing to potentially not charge you interest during this pandemic. And if they are, I see a lot of other credit card companies advertising, switch over to us and we won't charge you, you know, for some period of time.
Yeah. And I know people who are also doing forbearances on their mortgages, right? I mean, that's probably the biggest single expense I have every month. Right. If I was furloughed, Wells Fargo would be the first people I would call to say, hey, you know, I got to take a time out here on paying this thing.
I'm even seeing landlords sometimes helping, agreeing to defer rent payments for a couple of months and then make it up, you know, when business is back open again.
Yeah, good stuff here. Let's see more comments here. Rory Ramirez, hello from Mini Moves in Broadview, Illinois. Victoria McCullough, hi Ben from Plano, Texas. Hey, Victoria. Simon Johns asks another question. I don't know if you're familiar with UK law or if this question is universal, but he goes on to say, if you have been furloughed and you have in your contract that you can't undertake any other employment, but need to make up the shortfall, is the current contract void to these unprecedented times? We have 80% of an average salary equivalent of a maximum of £2,500 paid by the government. So I think what Simon's saying is, you know, normally we're not allowed to work for other companies as an employee of our current company, or it might be in our contract saying that. But if I'm on furlough, does that go out the window?
So it is a different analysis per country and per state. So for example, California doesn't allow any restrictions on non-competes, but let's say you were in Michigan and you had such non-compete, it can be enforceable after you're no longer with the company at times, but the concept is you have to be able to earn a livelihood. So if the way that it's worded is you can't get any job and it's not at all limited to a reasonable radius, like within 10 miles of my office or narrowly tailored to your scope of business, and the duration is for some limited period of time, without those three reasonable elements, and you can't earn a livelihood and make money elsewhere, potentially could be unenforceable as void against public policy.
Okay. So basically you need to have the ability to earn income. Jeff Livingston, hi, Ben in Atlanta. Hey, Jeff. Sandra Clary, thank you. I've been searching for the FAQs on this. I love this show. Thank you, Sandra. It's really nice, James, for you to take time out of your busy schedule. I mean, you're one of the, you know, biggest employment lawyers in the area, in the region, really. And you're so active out there. And I know you're pulled in a million directions. So for you to take an hour out and sit with us and answer these questions means a lot.
Yeah, I'm really happy to be here. I volunteer for the Michigan Society of Human Resource Management. I'm the director-elect this year, and I'll be the director next year. So I go to the national SHRM conferences where there's over 100,000 members of National SHRM, which is the organization that trains human resource professionals across the country. So I am very active with the other 50 states and dealing with their leaders to make sure we have the best resources available to try to help people get the right answers.
What are you seeing right now? So as the director-elect of SHRM for the state of Michigan and being on the national stage there as well, what are you seeing companies doing? What kind of strategies are they employing? What are some of the maybe the best practices or maybe some of the more ingenious strategies that companies are employing right now in these times?
Yeah, so I think this is a time for, regardless of your job title or position, you have the ability to step up and show your value. So I'm seeing companies create this kind of trusted advisory team, maybe someone that is a industry specialist in what you do, someone that knows how to communicate well, maybe you have to communicate by text message or virtually now. And are you having some empathetic board that's checking in with your employees at people, making sure they're doing okay? If you're making certain policies, make sure that you're open to a discussion. If your policy imposes an undue hardship on somebody, you're willing to talk to them and see if there's other things you can do. But companies that are able to quickly give everyone a laptop and allow them to work remotely or find some way to help them and share the resources, like the FAQs you just found on my website, if you could just share that with all these employees. I'm actually preparing unemployment links, educating my employees, not at Dinsmore, but my clients for employees, of how to file for unemployment benefits. A lot of employers want to help them. Many employers aren't even being charged from their unemployment account these benefits. It's paid by the state and federal government, the CARES Act. So here's the procedure. Let's help the employees file. Let's give them our best. Let's even give them a letter, the furlough letter, or some letter that's clear it's not misconduct. Like, I feel bad for that worker that was told it was a termination. That's extra stress where they may have to jump through some more hurdles to become eligible.
Yeah, no, I think if I was an employee that was faced with a furlough right now, you know, I would definitely want to have a letter like you described with links. Okay, here's how you go do it. And I would understand that my employer couldn't support me due to the slowdown, but they also want me to have the best experience possible. And to me, that would go a long way,
right?
You know, having that type of a resource.
And I think most people are, you're realists and realize that sometime this pandemic will end. It isn't the first pandemic we've ever had. And we want to have that goodwill when businesses are up and running and we need that talent.
Yeah. And then because you're going to bring them back. I mean, that's what a furlough is about, right?
That's,
hey, go sit on the sidelines for 3 months. We're going to bring you back. And it allows you to keep your health insurance too, a furlough or no?
Most companies are allowing you to keep your health insurance, and Blue Cross Blue Shield and a lot of other healthcare providers are being more flexible and allowing you to stay on health insurance for even longer. Many employers are even covering some of those co-pays just to help through this time.
Yeah, that's great. And I was doing some research on this difference between furlough and laid off. One thing that surprised me is that your last paycheck may not be guaranteed in a furlough situation as it would be with a layoff or a termination. Layoff or termination, it's like, hey, pick up your paycheck at the front desk on Monday or mail it to you or whatever. But I saw on a site, it may or may not be guaranteed you to actually receive that last paycheck. Have you heard that, or is that just misinformation?
Well, I don't fully agree with the statement. I think that if you're terminating somebody, many states require you to give them that paycheck the day you terminate them. Where if it was a furlough, you can still pay them in the ordinary course of business. And maybe if they were a partially commissioned worker, they're getting a more drawn out payment plan to be made whole, but they still, employers still have to follow minimum wage laws. And in Michigan, you have to pay someone no later than monthly. So you couldn't delay the final paycheck more than a month.
Okay. All right. Makes sense. Couple of questions here. I want to make sure we take care of these folks here who have been patiently waiting here. Jonathan Farmer, General Manager at MCS Creating Solutions in Texas, says, I have a technician that is asked to take off work until this is over. He is a new hire, less than 60 days of employment. I told him he could take off and that his position would be available when he wanted to return. Are there any steps I need to take to protect myself and my company? Does the CARES Act cover him in any way?
So I guess the question is he allowed to otherwise work? Technically, if he's just refusing safe and available work, that could be a disqualification event in many states from unemployment benefits. If you were laying him off, then he'd be able to get the full unemployment benefits. I think that to protect yourself, you may want to put in writing that he voluntarily resigned without good cause attributable to the company. You didn't force him to resign. That would be a good thing because you don't want him to sue for discrimination. Maybe he claims he was picked for inappropriate reasons to be terminated over someone else. And I'm a little uncomfortable with you guaranteeing his position will be open. You don't have a crystal ball, and you may find someone else that's even better in the interim. So I would be hesitant to guarantee someone will be automatically back. And I'd want to review your documents because oral contracts in many states are enforceable. So if you say, hang in there, buddy, I'll take care of you, you can no longer even terminate them without them essentially stealing from you. Like if you're making some type of relationship that you're now a partnership or working together, that could change the terms. So I always am clear in the states that allow it, have a written document that says, unless the CEO says otherwise in writing, it's always an at-will relationship where either one of us can be separated at any time for any or no reason.
Great explanation. Jonathan, let me know if that answers your question, if you have a follow-up. Very thorough. James, that's what I love when I talk to you. You know, I remember having a pizza out in Southfield and just getting into stuff. Yeah. And you really dig into the nuances there and the what ifs and the if this, then this kind of thing. And you're always thinking two, three steps ahead, you know, which that's why I love your advice.
You know, give the answer of what I think they're really looking for, even if they didn't ask it exactly that right now.
Well, because so many people don't, I mean, we don't even know how to ask the questions a lot of times.
That's my biggest point. When I do training, I'm not trying to get anyone attending today's event to be an expert in all the laws. I just want you to spot the issues. I think most companies and managers, we're all good people at heart for the most part. So if we're able to spot the issues, we can then, you know, find a trusted advisor or resource and get the answers.
Yeah. Great. Awesome. Let's see here. So Victoria McCullough says, in Texas, you can't even get through to the website right now. Talking about the unemployment, I'm sure. I have to try it at very odd hours and hopefully you can get in. So it's not even waiting on the phone to get benefits, but even going to the website, the traffic is just overrunning it, I guess.
I have heard that too. I have heard getting up in the middle of the night to try to go on the trap. My wife can't even order groceries online because there's no delivery date available and there's weird hours of the night she's trying to go on and just put an order through. So the internet and at many stores and even the unemployment agency is overworked right now.
I mean, tell me about it. I just got kicked off the stream because, I mean, the internet's breaking right now. Exactly. You know, it's like COVID's breaking the internet. Rory Ramirez says, here's a question for you. What if you have an employee with someone in their household that is sick, yet they tested negative? Can that employer request for the employee to come back to work? Will the employee not get fired if they refuse coming back to work? Do they need a doctor's note saying to self-isolate for 14 days?
So, you know, just to be clear, I represent business owners and companies. So I'm happy to talk hypotheticals for fun, but this hypothetical is a little unusual because I typically would not want someone that's been exposed to someone with COVID-19 to come back to work. Yes, there's a chance, even though they tested negative that minute, doesn't mean they're not going to see their kid while they're still contagious that night or the next day and become contagious. So if someone is, you know, becoming within 6 feet exposed to someone with coronavirus, I would not want to force them to come back to work. And other issues you have is there, as I said, in the FFCRA, the Family First Coronavirus Response Act, that's a triggering event where they could have sick leave rights or FMLA rights to take care of that sick child. So I would not want to terminate them because they want to be home with that child or care for that sick child. And I probably wouldn't want to force them to work when they're likely to be contagious.
And is that taking care of the family member fall under that $511 a day for 10 days?
Unfortunately, that's the 2/3 pay cap up to $200 a day.
Okay. Yeah, there's so many different programs with so many different benefits, right?
It's complicated. You know?
Yeah, and if you have any documents like that from Dinsmore that you want to share that you're putting out there just as FAQs or whatever, I'd love to post it on the Love and Relo Facebook page as well as a resource. Again, James.
Absolutely.
Yeah, James, I mean, this is really fantastic. Rory did offer a follow-up to that question, said, the child tested negative, the employee was not tested.
So if the child's negative and the employee... you have no reason to believe he has any symptoms, then you should bring him back to work.
Otherwise, he's refusing work, and then
right,
yeah, that's a slippery slope. I mean, especially right now, emotions are high. You know, people are worried. You know, yep. they're operating under an abundance of caution. They're hearing the governor kind of say one thing: stay at home. You know, shelter in place. Don't take chances. You know, flatten the curve and yet they feel an obligation and a duty to be at work as well. And it's just, it's a difficult time for people. I get it.
I now is the best time to be empathetic and just check in. I'm enjoying just having some people interaction, making sure we're doing okay. And I like the empathy people gave to that person that was terminated and furloughed. It's a tough time. So hang in there and, you know, we'll get through this together.
Yeah, for sure. Jeff Livingston, great program and timely. Yes. Yeah, I think so too. I'm happy you guys like it. Let's see. Groceries 3 to 4 days out. People are having grocery issues for sure. Doesn't sound like much, but when you can't get that bologna for 3 days, I mean, you start thinking about it.
You know, you're either going to gain the COVID-19 or lose the COVID-19, depending on the grocery order.
That's right. So let's see here. Jonathan follows up on that question about the tech and kind of guaranteeing him work when he wants to come back. He says, yes, I guess that did answer his question. Thank you for answering the question. As hard as it is to find techs willing to work third-party services, there's a very good chance his position will be available, though I understand your stance of protecting myself. And that's what James is all about. I mean, James is about protecting you and making sure that you're not exposing your company. You know, for all you business owners out there, and I know there's a lot of them watching this right now on LinkedIn, a lot of business owners, a lot of general managers who are in charge of putting policies together that we've never contemplated in our lifetime. I mean, this is kind of new territory, I think. Simon Johns from the UK. So if you can't get through to a bank or credit card company because of high demand of callers, you want to discuss the present financial situation and worries about paying, can you just stop direct debits? And what would be the repercussions of this? Hey, I can't call you right now. I'm just going to stop paying. We'll sort it out later.
Yeah. So, you know, I'm not in a position to give that type of advice, but I do understand that strategy. And sometimes people, instead of asking for permission, they just take action and ask for forgiveness later. So that is the way the real life works. So I understand your strategic business risk that you're trying to take.
It's a really, really nice diplomatic way to put that, James. Yeah, I would just send them an email to their info@company inbox, and I would just say, hey, this is notice. I'm not paying. Cut the debits off. I mean, again, I'm not a lawyer.
I have heard that if you put in that notice, it does give you a better argument than just the silence and not paying. And you risk a claim potentially of that higher interest rate for not paying timely.
Yeah, I mean, banks send me stuff in my mailbox all the time and consider it red. So I just do the same back to them, you know. Maureen Longoria, great program, Ben. James, info was terrific. Bravo. Yeah, I'm glad you guys are getting some value out of this. This is exactly what I thought. I know this is a little different from what we normally do, but just thinking to myself, you know, this is what's on my mind. You know, if I wake up tomorrow and I get furloughed or I get laid off, or if I have to turn around and furlough people in my organization, I'm having a lot of questions right now in my brain. And James, I mean, you've answered a lot of them for us. I know we're kind of running out of time here, but I wanted to ask you really quickly, since you're out there and you're meeting with companies and clients all the time, virtually now, I'm sure.
Yeah.
You know, is there any advice or things that continue to come up that you want to leave people with as they're thinking through these issues?
My advice is to try to sink or swim during this time. And I believe all of us can swim by trying to adapt to a new habit. I'm trying to create better habits for myself. I'm trying to use this change as a way to live a healthier lifestyle, become more efficient, and even find ways to improve my family life with my kids, my wife, and my work. So I really think the takeaway is change is inevitable. And when there are challenging times ahead, that's where you can build trust and prove yourself. If you're taking care of someone that needs it right now, whether it's your employer or a neighbor or a family member, they're going to really value that for years to come. I built my career by essentially swimming through the 2008 downturn. When everyone thought the world was coming to an end in 2008, instead of me crying, I didn't have much litigation work to do, I actually switched my career path to counseling companies on how to right size and become profitable again and how to deal with the crisis. I've tried to become a solution and be proactive, not just reactive. So if all of us can develop a skill set of trying to get a way to be proactive and maybe change our career path out of this and be a trusted resource or a valued friend to people in need, I think it'll pay off down the road.
That's excellent advice. I mean, yeah, stay positive and look for opportunity, because in change, there's always opportunity, you know, and if you can make it in the downtime, you're gonna be very successful in the boons. You know, James, thank you so much for being on today. This has just been fantastic. I've learned a lot. If people want to get a hold of James Reid and, you know, get any of these types of letters for their company or have him work through some specific issues at your company, he's a fabulous resource, specializes in employment law, specializes working with HR professionals. So I strongly recommend James. He's been a wealth of information today and always. So thank you, James, again for coming.
No, thanks for having me on, and I look forward to doing it again.
Yeah, sounds great. Can't wait.
Can't wait.
Right, take care, everybody. Stay positive out there.